It has been wonderful to be with you folks this week. Thank you for your faithfulness. I know these are busy, busy times, and I think that's one reason why churches no longer ever have extended meetings, revival meetings. I mean, this is so rare. Nobody does this because people won't come. They're too busy, they've got busy schedules, and well, sometimes they just don't care. So we're very grateful that all of you are here tonight and for your faithfulness this week. Let me just mention one thing before we get into our text tonight. I really want to encourage you, if you struggle in your Christian life, in any area of your Christian life, I encourage you to pick up the DVD series of our Cross Power Weekend. It's not because of us, but I'm telling you folks, what we teach in that weekend, in those seven sessions, are life-changing, life-transforming, and I'm not exaggerating. It is just wonderful truth about the cross. When we do one of those Crossbar weekends, I don't believe we have ever done one where we have not had several people come up and say, I've been saved 40 years, but I never saw the cross that way. It's been probably a year ago, we did a Crossbar weekend, and a gentleman came up and says, you know what, I've been saved almost 60 years, I have never understood the cross like I do now. We hear that over and over and over again. So it's a three DVDs, seven sessions with an accompanying study guide. And it's very reasonably priced. We're not really making any money on it. But we want as many people to get this Bible study. It's on a DVD. It'll play in your computer, it'll play on your DVD player, play on your Blu-ray player, you know, whatever. But I encourage you to pick up one of those Bible studies and then use it at home. And when you're finished, pass it on to somebody else. Charge them more than we did. Take your Bibles, please, and turn to Acts chapter 12, would you please? Acts chapter 12. 12th chapter of the book of Acts. Now, Pastor Grove, I did not ask your permission, and I should have. Is it okay if I make an announcement tonight? Is that all right? Is it okay? Do you need to have a deacon's meeting or anything like that? Need? Okay. I can make an announcement? All right, here it is. Here is my announcement tonight. God is in control. God is in control. All of the messages that I have preached so far have been pretty hard. I mean, they have been preaching on sin, and last night, the sin of pride that every one of us struggles with. And I really believe that God would have us just to be encouraged tonight. And we're going to look at Acts chapter 12. We're going to go through the entire chapter, and I hope when we are finished, we will all agree with great excitement and enthusiasm that God is in control. And I hope you'll take notes. I always encourage people to take notes. And here is the first point in the outline tonight, all right? Acts chapter 12, and here it is. God is in control even when I suffer. That's verses 1 through 5. God is in control even when I suffer. Let's look at Acts chapter 12, verses 1 through 5. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church. And he killed James, the brother of John, with a sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of unleavened bread. Now let's stop there for just a moment, then we'll read verses 4 and 5. Let's put the message into context. At this time, the megachurch in Jerusalem is no longer a megachurch. We read in Acts chapter 2 that there were 3,000 men that were saved one day and were baptized. That didn't count the women and children. Some people estimate that there were 5 to 7,000 people that were saved and baptized, were added to the church on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. But when we come to Acts chapter 8 and 9, great persecution arose towards the church in Jerusalem. And most of the people in the church in Jerusalem fled for their lives. Most. The overwhelming majority of this congregation, by the time we get to Acts chapter 12, have gone and they have spread all over the known world, get this, taking the gospel with them everywhere they went. We don't know how many are left, but it's not a large number. There are a few of the disciples, a few of the people, and Herod, the king, the Roman king, has decided we haven't gotten rid of enough of them. We need to wipe them all out. We need to destroy this movement, these people who follow Jesus because they think he's a king. And so it is the deep desire of Herod to wipe them out fully and completely. And so he does a little experiment. He arrests James, the brother of John, one of the leaders of the church, and lops his head off. Cuts his head off. Now, why did he do that? He wanted to see how the Jews would respond. Because you see, the Jews and the Romans were enemies. They hated each other. But they had one thing in common. They both hated the Christians. Remember the old saying, the enemy of my enemy is my friend? And so Herod doesn't want to tick off the Jews. He wants to destroy the Christians, and he doesn't know how they would respond. So he arrests James, the brother of John, lops off his head, and the Jews love it. Now think about this. The early church just has two enemies in Jerusalem. That's all. Just two. The Roman government, the most powerful political force on planet Earth. They were the enemy of the church. Then their other enemy was the Jewish religion, which just happened to be the most powerful religious force in that part of the world. So the early church just had two enemies, the most powerful political force on the earth and the most powerful religious force in that particular part of the world. And both of them were conspiring together to destroy the early church. So verse 3, because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter. Now why Peter? Peter was the head of the church. He was the spokesperson for the church. So he kills James and he thinks, okay, that went well. The Jews loved it. We'll just go right to the head and we'll take Peter and we're going to kill him as well. Verse 4. And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison. And look at this. And delivered him to four quaternions of soldiers to keep him. Now, how many soldiers were in a quaternion? Quattro, four. So four quaternions of soldiers, which means how many soldiers were assigned personally to guard Peter? 16. Isn't that amazing? And I assure you, because Peter was Herod's prize prisoner, these were not just flunkies in the army. These were battle-hardened, special, selected, probably special forces, troops in the battle-hardened Roman army were personally selected, hand-selected by Herod himself to guard Peter. Intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison. Now, note, remember the other night we had a quiz? Going to have another quiz here in just a few minutes, all right? Notice in verse 5. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. So what were they doing down at the church? They were praying, and they were praying fervently for Peter. Here's the first point. God is in control even when I suffer. There is a lot of false teaching about suffering today, and you hear a lot of it on TV and radio. If you listen to some of the TV evangelists, they will tell you that if you have enough faith And if you speak words of faith, you will never suffer. Now, you also have to send them a little money. That's part of the equation. You have to send in your seed faith offering. And you are told by these guys on TV, and we have one of them here in Columbus, and they will tell you that if you speak words of faith, if you affirm your faith, and if you sow your financial seed, you will not suffer. You won't be sick, and if you are sick, you will be immediately healed. You will never be poor, you will be rich. You'll be driving a big car, living in a big house, and you will never suffer. I want to say something very, very strongly, but I mean it with all my heart, and I can back it up from Scripture. That is a heresy from the devil himself. It is not taught in Scripture. It is not. Look at all of the apostles. Every single one of them died a martyr's death, except for John the Revelator, and he died exile, thank you. He died in exile on the island of Patmos. Now, if this word faith stuff really worked, don't you think that the guys who heard it first from Jesus himself would be walking around in rich clothes, living in big houses? They had big houses in Bible times. They all lived in poverty. And they all suffered. It makes no sense biblically. But God is in control. Even when I suffer, and I want you to know something, folks, we are not exempt from suffering simply because of our sincerity. Many people think I'm suffering with this or I'm suffering with that simply because I'm not sincere enough. Well, who was more sincere than Peter? Now, before the resurrection, Peter was kind of a jerk. Did I really say that? Peter was a jerk? Well, he was. I mean, before the resurrection, Peter could be a real jerk. He was constantly putting his foot in his mouth and saying things that he shouldn't say. And never forget, the one and only time that Jesus really needed him. I never heard of the blankety blank so-and-so, and he cursed and swore and said, I never heard of him. But after the resurrection, Peter was a mighty soldier of the cross, fearless. And there was no one more sincere than Peter. And yet, where is he? He is in a Roman prison. They were not exactly the Hilton. They were not the Holiday Inn. They were horrible, awful places to be. And he's chained to two soldiers and guarded by 14 more. Listen, just because you're sincere does not mean that you're exempt from suffering. Some people think that we're exempt from suffering if we're in the service of God. Well, I'm suffering because I'm not doing enough for God. And because I'm suffering, I need to do more. Well, who was doing more than Peter? And yet he's suffering and he's facing an agonizing, horrible, terrifying death at the hands of the Romans. We're not exempt from suffering simply because of our sincerity or our service. Neither are we exempt from suffering because of our stature. Some people think I'm suffering because I'm not important to God. If I was a missionary, if I was a pastor, then I wouldn't suffer because important people in God's service don't suffer. Well, here in our text, no one is more important in God's service than Peter. No one is more important to the church in Jerusalem than Peter, and yet he is suffering terribly. This is a heresy that teaches that if you are faithful to God, you won't suffer. If you're important to God, you won't suffer. If you are in God's service, you won't suffer. If you just had enough faith, you wouldn't suffer. It's a heresy and it's not true. It is not found in Scripture, nor is it found in the history of the church. If you read the biographies of the great men and women of God in Scripture and throughout Christian history, you will find this thing. They lived in different centuries. They lived in different places on our planet. They had all different kinds of personalities. God uses all kinds of people. But here's the thing that they all have in common. All of them have gone through terrible times of suffering. It's true. One of my great heroes of the faith is C.H. Spurgeon, the great English pastor in London, England in the mid-1800s. By the time he was 20 years old, he was regularly preaching to crowds of 10,000 people out on countrysides without any amplification, no microphones. By the time he was 30, he was pastoring one of the largest churches in the world, and there was not an auditorium in London, England that would hold the crowds, and so they built one of the largest churches in the world in London, England, the Metropolitan Tabernacle. And yet it was not large enough to hold the crowds that came to hear C.H. Spurgeon. Spurgeon got an idea. There were so many people who wanted to get in to hear him preach. He announced one Sunday that on such and such a Sunday, a few weeks away, they were going to designate it Seeker Sunday at Metropolitan Tabernacle. And get this, Pastor Grove. C.H. Spurgeon stood in his pulpit and said, on such and such a Sunday, it's going to be Seeker Sunday, and I'm asking all of you to stay home. I don't want any of you to come. We're going to announce in the newspapers that we're opening the doors to the Metropolitan Tabernacle to seekers. And so his congregation stayed home. They put advertisements in the London newspapers that it was Seeker Sunday. And guess what? So many people showed up trying to get in the doors and finding a seat that they had a stampede, and several people were seriously injured because the unsaved seekers were trying to get in to hear C.H. Spurgeon preach. And from then on, when they had a Seeker Sunday and they did it again, they passed out tickets. They didn't cost, but they passed out tickets to avoid the stampede of people who wanted to get in and hear the great C.H. Spurgeon preach. Many American newspapers featured every week a sermon of C.H. Spurgeon on the front page of their newspaper here in America. He was considered to be probably the greatest preacher that ever lived, other than possibly the Apostle Paul. And yet, if you read an honest biography of C.H. Spurgeon, you will learn this. For at least the last 10 years of his life and the last 10 years of his ministry, every single year he took anywhere from 3 to 4 months off every year to retreat to Mentone, France, where he would recover physically, but also emotionally and spiritually, because guess what? The great C.H. Spurgeon suffered greatly physically. He had gout and many other physical problems as well. But he also suffered from severe depression. The Prince of Preachers, possibly the greatest preacher since the time of Paul, suffered from horrible, debilitating depression. So bad that he couldn't preach, he couldn't speak to anyone, and he would go to Mentone, France, and get all alone and pray and fast and read scripture so that the dark clouds of depression would blow away, so that he could finally go back to his pulpit and preach again. Today, if a pastor were to admit that he suffered from depression, he'd probably get fired. We pigeonhole people because they suffer from depression. And we say, well, just read your Bible a little more, pray a little more. Depression is very real many times in the church because we live in an evil, wicked world. I want you to know this. Just because you're a Christian and you're sincere and you're spiritually mature does not mean that you are exempt from suffering. Suffering is a part of this life. Suffering in Christian families is a part of life. physical suffering, financial suffering, emotional suffering. We are not exempt, but God is in control. Even when I suffer, God is in control. Here's the second point. We'll go a little faster. God is in control even at midnight. God is in control even at midnight. That's verses 6 through 10. And when Herod would have brought him forth the same night. Now what do I derive from that? This is the night before he's going to be executed. I think we can assume that. This is the night before he is going to be executed, and I'm sure he knows that. And when Herod would have brought him forth the same night, Peter was, he was doing what? Talk to me. What was he doing? You got to be kidding me. Come on now. Come on. What do we know about Romans and their executions? They didn't believe in prohibiting cruel and unusual punishment. You know, when today in America, when we execute someone, we want to make sure that we don't hurt them. Hello? But it's true. It's true. The Romans didn't care about that. We know a couple things about Roman executions. They were always public, and they were always painful. Why? They wanted to instill fear in people. They wanted people to fear the government. And so they executed people publicly, and they wanted it to be as painful and as excruciating as possible. That's why they invented the cross. And so tomorrow morning, Peter is going to be executed by the Romans. And what was he doing again? Tell me. I got news, folks. If I knew I was going to be executed tomorrow morning by the Romans, you could give me a whole case, a whole carton of Ambien, and I wouldn't be sleeping. And when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door kept the prison. Remember how many guards were guarding him? 16. In verse 7, this is amazing. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison. Do bright lights in the middle of the night wake you up? Oh, they do me. You know, you're sound asleep, somebody comes in and throws on all the lights. Doesn't wake up Peter. Behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side. Peter is in such a deep sleep that the bright light doesn't wake him. The angel has to smack him around. The angel has to come to Peter and smack him and say, come on, Pete, wake up. We got places to go, things to do. I love this. A light shined in the prison. He smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise up quickly. And his chains fell off his hand. And the angel said unto him, gird thyself and bind on thy sandals. All right, Peter, get dressed. Get dressed. And so he did. And he saith unto him, cast thy garment about thee. Come on, Peter, at least cooperate. Do your part. Get your clothes on. Get your shoes on. Get your... Come on, Peter. Put your clothes on. And he went out and followed him, and wist not that it was true, which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. He thought he was dreaming. He's thinking, man, this is such a cool dream. It's going to be bad when I wake up, but boy, is it nice now. He thinks he's dreaming. Now, let me ask you a question. Now, don't forget, folks, the characters in Scripture were real human beings just like you and me. They were not supernatural. They didn't have an S on their chest. They didn't go flying through the air. They were regular, normal, average human beings just like you and me. They had the same pain, the same fears, the same emotions that all of us do. So, understanding that, how in the world could Peter, knowing that he is going to die a horrifically painful death tomorrow morning, how could he be sound asleep? How do we explain that? You know the answer. Because he knew something. He knew God was in control. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, in John chapter 21, verse 8, we won't take time to turn there, but in John chapter 28, after the resurrection, Jesus promised Peter something. You will not die until you're an old man. John 21, 8, check it out. Write it down. Check it out when you get home. Jesus told Peter, you will not die until you're an old man. Well, guess what? He's not an old man yet. So, Peter has a choice. He has the circumstances on one hand. And how are the circumstances? They're bad. They're really, really, really bad. In fact, honest question, what are the odds that Peter is going to escape from this Roman prison? Zero. Are you kidding me? 16 battle-hardened Roman soldiers, a couple of iron gates, the odds of him escaping are zero. So what are the odds that he is going to die tomorrow morning, a horrible, horrific, painful death? What are the odds? 100%, right? So, Peter has overwhelming circumstances on one hand. And on the other hand, he has the promise of Jesus Christ. From the fact that he is sound asleep tells us which he has chosen. He has ignored the circumstances, and he is believing the promise of Jesus. Jesus told me I wasn't going to die until I'm an old man, and I'm not an old man yet, so I'm not dying tomorrow morning. Folks, listen to me. We are constantly faced with choosing to believe the circumstances or the promises of God. Joy and I and our family are going through kind of a tough time right now. Her sister is very near death. We haven't heard yet today. But there are some other things going on in our family that is really stretching our faith. We are facing a couple circumstances that seem absolutely impossible, just to be really honest with you. And so we are facing the same choice I'm giving to you. We can look at impossible circumstances, or we can believe the promise of God. You see, for Peter, it was midnight. You know, it was midnight. There was no way out. There was no hope, humanly speaking, physically speaking, logically speaking, rationally speaking. There was no hope. It was midnight with no way out. And yet, Peter understood something. God was in control. Maybe tonight you're facing a midnight. Maybe you have faced a midnight. If you have not faced a midnight or two in your life and in your experience, I promise you, you will. You will come to places in your life, your family, that there's no way out. There's no escape. It's impossible. But God is in control. God is in control when I suffer, but God is in control even at midnight. Verse 9. He went out and followed him, which and wist not that it was true, which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. When they were past the first and second ward, they came unto the iron gate that leadeth into the city, which opened to them of his own accord. And they went out and passed on through one street, and forthwith the angel departed from him. And I love verse 11. It says, and when Peter was come to himself, he does not understand this is real until he is all the way out in the street outside the prison. He says, now I know of a surety that the Lord has sent his angel and hath delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews. And I want you to know something, folks. God will send an angel to you if you need one. Did you get that? God will send an angel to you if you need one. Can I tell you a quick story? And I don't want to go too long tonight, but I got to tell you this quick story. We have three children. They're all adopted. Our son was the prodigal. He was. He was in and out of jail and drugs and alcohol and you name it. And he ran away from home. I can't tell you how many times he ran away. And when he would run away, we would both kind of panic, and Joy would get on the phone and call the prayer chain of the church and call the people of the church, pray, Tim's gone, we don't know where he is, pray for us and pray for him. And if we didn't hear from him for several hours, Joy would start calling the sheriff's department and the Westerville police, and of course you call the emergency rooms at the hospitals. And then he would come back, praise God. But one night, we were at church on the other side of Westerville. I think it was Sunday evening service, and after the service, Tim was gone. We didn't know where he was, and we went out to get in the car, and there was a note on the steering wheel, and it looked like a suicide note. And talk about distressed. But we made a determination. This time we're going to tell nobody but God, no one. We're not going to tell anybody. We're not going to call anyone. We're not calling the police. We're not reporting a missing person. We're not telling anybody in the church. We're going to tell God alone. And we went home. In fact, that was about three blocks from here. And we began praying. And we trusted God. And we actually went to bed and went to sleep. And at 5:30, the phone rang. Well, the phone rings at 5:30 is never good news. It was the Ohio Highway Patrol, 5:30. This Mr. Burney? Yes. This is the Ohio Highway Patrol, and we picked up your son on I-71 north of Columbus. He was hitchhiking. It's illegal to hitchhike on interstate highways. And we have him here. We can either bring him to your house. He doesn't want to come home. He wants to go to a friend's house, who lived on College Avenue. And I said, we're just thankfully safe. If he wants to go to his friend's house, that's fine. And I'll tell him I'll pick him up later today. And we just rejoiced that he was safe. Just praise God that he was safe. Late that morning, I went over to the friend's house and told Tim, let's go home. He got in the car and he was angry. And I said, what's the matter, son? Why are you angry? He says, you always do that. I said, what? He said, you always call everybody. I didn't mean the note. I wouldn't have hurt myself. And I would have come home eventually. But you always call everybody. I said, no. We didn't call anybody. No one. We didn't tell a single person that you had run away. He says, yes, you did. I said, no, we didn't. I'm telling you the truth. I said, why do you say this? And here's what he told me. He said, I was walking up I-71 trying to pick up a ride, and a highway patrol car pulled over. Pulled right up beside me, and the highway patrolman rolled down the passenger side window. And he said, son, is your name Tim? And our son said, yes. And he says, get in the car. I've been looking for you all night. I have no idea, Joy and I have no idea, whether God supernaturally touched a highway patrolman's heart. We have no idea who he was. We don't know his name. Have no idea how to find out. It was years ago. Or whether there was an angel in a highway patrol uniform that picked up our son. All we know is that it was midnight and God was in control. Let's hurry. God is in control even when I suffer. God is in control even at midnight when there's no hope. But also God is in control when my faith is weak. This may be my favorite part. Back to the text. Now, what were they doing down at the church? Quiz time. They were praying. And how do you think they were praying? Now remember, the day of Pentecost is still in the rearview mirror. I mean, the day of Pentecost hadn't happened very long ago. So they're down somewhere in somebody's house and they're praying. It's the church. And they're having a prayer meeting and they're praying for Peter. We read that. Now how do you think they were praying? Oh Lord, it's bad. It's really bad. Well, they killed James. Now they're going to kill Peter. And then they're going to kill all of us. We're all going to die. Oh, Lord, help Peter to die with a smile on his face. And Lord, when they come and get us, help us to die with a smile on our face. It's so bad. Do you think that's how they were praying? Of course not. I know how they were praying. They were praying, Lord, you are God. You are sovereign. Herod is big, but you're bigger. Rome is powerful, but you're more powerful. Oh God, deliver our brother Peter. We know you can deliver him. We know you can set him free. Don't you think that's how they were praying? Of course they were. They were praying prayers of faith for Peter. Okay, with that in mind, let's go to the text. And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. So he found the prayer meeting. And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken named Rhoda. Now here's what happened. They're in there on their knees and they're praying all these wonderful prayers of faith. And all of a sudden somebody, the chairman of the deacons, it had to be the chairman of the deacons, the chairman of the deacon says, psst, Rhoda, we're busy here praying for Peter. Go and see who's at the door. And Rhoda, bless her heart, okay. So Rhoda goes to the door, it says, and as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken named Rhoda. And when she knew Peter's voice, she opened not the gate for gladness, but ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate. So get the picture. Get the picture. Rhoda is so flipping out excited because she hears Peter's voice. She runs into the prayer meeting and she says, God answered our prayers. God answered our prayers. Peter is at the gate. It's wonderful. It's a miracle. Peter has been delivered from the Romans. And guess how they respond. Verse 15. And they said unto her, you are nuts. The King James says, thou art mad. The chairman of the deacon, it had to be the chairman of the deacon. Chairman of the deacon says, Rhoda, you are three French fries short of a Happy Meal, girl. Rhoda, your elevator just, it doesn't go to the top floor. Poor Rhoda, she's about a quart low, you know. They said that. You're crazy. You are nuts. You are mad. But she wouldn't shut up. She constantly affirmed that it was even so. And then look at this. Then said they, it's his angel. He's dead. And his ghost is at the door. It's his angel. We were praying, but we knew he was going to die. Don't you love their faith? Don't you love their faith? They're in there praying these prayers for Peter. Prayers of faith. Prayers of deliverance. Peter's at the door. And they won't believe it. Doesn't that sound like you sometimes? It sure sounds like me sometimes. I can remember many prayer meetings at our church and here in Westerville. Somebody would pray and pray and pray, and they would come on Wednesday nights to prayer meeting and say, you got to pray about this, pray about this, pray about this. And then a few weeks later, they come and they say, oh, I can't believe it. God answered prayer. And everybody responds with shock, right? Of course God answers prayer. He doesn't always answer the way we want Him to, and He hardly ever answers when we want Him to, but He always answers. I am so grateful, folks, that God does not answer because of a faithometer in heaven. You know, I'm glad there's no faithometer, you know. In heaven, there's this gauge, a faithometer. And when you're praying, the faithometer, you know, scores. And you're at 30% and 40%. And you really, really, really pray fervently. And you finally get that faithometer over to 70%. And God says, I'm not answering until you get to 80%. Listen, I know that Scripture says without faith it is impossible to please God, but I also know that Scripture says with faith the size of a mustard seed, you can move a mountain. I am so grateful that God is in control, even when our faith is very, very weak. I'm so grateful that God's in control, even when our faith is weak. Can I confess to you that some of the difficult times that Joy and I have been through in our marriage and our family, there were times that my faith, I think, was much smaller than a mustard seed. And yet God has always answered. In His time, in His way. So let's review. What's the first point? God is in control what? Even when I suffer. Second point, God is in control when? Even at midnight. Third point, God is in control even when my faith is weak. Thou art mad, but she constantly affirmed that it was even so. Then they said, it's his angel. So where's Peter? He's outside still knocking. But Peter continued knocking. And when they had opened the door and saw him, they said, well, praise God, we knew that you would be free. Is that what it says? They were astonished. They were shocked that God had actually answered their prayer. But he, beckoning unto them with a hand to hold their peace, declared unto them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he said, go show these things unto James and the brethren. And he departed and went unto another place. Here's the final point, and then we're done. God is in control, even when evil seems to prosper. Verses 18 to 25. God is in control, even when evil seems to prosper. Verse 18. Now, as soon as it was day, there was no small stir among the soldiers. What was become of Peter? Well, of course not. What happened to a Roman soldier if their prisoner escaped? Well, we read it in the next verse. And when Herod had sought for him and found him not, he examined the keepers and commanded that they should be put to death. Now very quickly, folks, listen. What did those soldiers do wrong? Nothing. Could any of them prohibit the escape of Peter? Could either any of them stop it? So they were completely innocent, right? Listen, when evil men are in control, sometimes innocent people die. It's true. Look at the Holocaust, Hitler. Look at how many innocent people died because evil people were in control. And look at America and abortion. Millions of innocent, unborn babies have died because evil people are in control on both sides of the political aisle. Verse 20, and Herod was highly displeased with them, Tyre and Sidon. But they came with one accord to him, and having made Blastus the king's chamberlain their friend, desired peace, because their country was nourished by the king's country. Verse 20 is a political thing, and I'll let your pastor explain it sometime. But verse 21, and upon a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat upon his throne and made an oration unto them. Now let me ask you just real quick. It is a wonderful, wonderful thing that Peter has been delivered, right? Does that make it better or worse for the church? Think about it. It's wonderful. Oh, Peter has escaped. Oh, no. Now what is Herod going to do to us? His prize prisoner has escaped. If he hated the church before, multiply that 100 times. I mean, when we entered chapter 12, it was bad for the church. It was really, really bad. The Jews and the Romans were conspiring together to kill them all and wipe them out. Whew, it's really escalated now. Verse 22. And the people gave a shout, saying, "It's the voice of a god and not a man." If you ever read the Jewish historian Josephus, he was a Jewish man that was a historian that lived during the time of Jesus. He writes extensively about there were several Herods, not just this one, there were several Herods. He writes more about this Herod than any other. And here's what he writes. This was the most obstinate, the most arrogant of all of the Herods. And Josephus writes that he lived such an opulent lifestyle that he had his tailors make thread out of real gold and real silver. Real gold, real silver, made thread out of it and interwove it in his robes that he would wear when he would give a speech. And Josephus said there was so much gold and silver thread in these garments that he wore that if he stood in the sun, the reflection would blind you. Evidently, he was wearing one of those garments that Josephus writes about in verse 21. He was arrayed in royal apparel, sat upon the throne. He made a speech, an oration, and the people gave a shout saying, "It's the voice of a god and not a man." All right, now, on a scale of 1 to 10, how bad is it for the church? Come on, talk to me. About a 15. All right? On a scale of 1 to 10, it's about a 15. It looks bad, 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 bad for the church. Herod is furious. He's been humiliated. And now they think he's a god. And he's going to find those Christians as soon as he can and finish the job. He will not be humiliated by Peter or any of those Christians. It's bad. It's worse than midnight. But look at verse 23. Look at verse 23. And immediately the angel of the Lord smote him, because he gave not God the glory, and he was eaten of worms and gave up the ghost. Now look at verse 22 again. How bad was it for the church in verse 22? Terrible, horrible. It's hard to imagine how it could get worse. And look at verse 23. God takes care of it. And then look at verse 24. But the word of the Lord grew and multiplied. How long did it take God to turn that whole thing around? One verse. That's it. Just one verse. In verse 22, it's all done. It's all over. It's finished. It's worse than midnight. They're all going to die. And two verses later, but the word of God. The enemy of the church dies, but not the word of God and not the church. But the word of God grew and multiplied. And look, and Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem when they had fulfilled their ministry and took with them John, whose surname was Mark. Now, in verse 22, it's bad, it's done, it's over, it's finished, the church is going to be destroyed, they're all going to die. And you know what happens in chapter 13? In the first 5 verses of chapter 13, because of what happens in verse 25, Barnabas and Saul returned and so forth, the modern missionary movement was begun in chapter 13. This guy named Saul, you ever heard of him? He became Paul, and Barnabas became the two, the first two missionaries sent out by the church. The modern missionary movement began about six verses after verse 22, when everything was over, finished, done. Now, that's when the modern missionary movement began. When did it end? It hasn't ended. It continues today. A movement of world evangelism was begun just a few verses after everything was done. Everything was finished. It looked like the devil was in control. It looked like the devil was going to win. It looked like the church was going to be destroyed. But, the word of the Lord grew and multiplied. I don't know what's going on in your world. I don't know what's going on in your family. I don't know what's going on in your life. I don't know what's going on in your finances. I don't know what's going on with your health. But I know this: God is in control. God is in control. Rehearse it with me one more time. God is in control when? Even when I suffer. Second, God is in control when? Even at midnight. God is in control what? Even when my faith is weak. And finally, God is in control when? Even when evil seems to prosper. God is in control. Father, I just want to thank you and praise you that you're in control. Even at midnight, even when we suffer, even when we don't understand and can't comprehend, and we don't know what in the world is happening, and it looks like there's no way out, and it's over, and it's finished. And even when we're surrounded by evil people in an evil world, and evil permeates our society and our country, and evil tries to destroy the church and the work of Christ, you are in control. So, Father, tonight, I'm sure there are folks here that are faced with a choice: circumstances or the promises of God. I pray that we would make the choice that Peter did, and so that whatever we're facing, when we put our heads on our pillows tonight, I pray we'll be able to sleep with the confidence of knowing that you're in control. I pray it in the wonderful, precious, awesome, powerful name of Jesus. Amen.